Okay, I don't know if you guys saw or not, but there was a recent stock market crash. I'm sure some of you have heard from earlier this week on the 5th, I believe that's when it happened. Look at this. This is just one of the graphs, right? And then look, you can just look it up, right? And you can instantly find articles about this, right? And look what Patrick had to say, like a day before it happened. He already knew. Brace for impact. Tomorrow opening of the market will reveal a ton. Few strange events taking place, causing concern amongst investors. Number one, rumors of an underground bunker in Jerusalem where senior leaders can remain for an extended period of time during a war has been prepared by the Shin Bet Security Service and is fully operational. The Walla News site reported on Sunday amid fear of attacks on Israel from Hezbollah and Iran. Holy shit, dude. This right here, this is when it starts to get suspicious, you know what I mean? Like when billionaires start building underground bunkers, it's like, what do they know? You know what I mean? Like, why is Zuckerberg doing it, right? Like, why are these people doing it? It's because they know something's going to happen. Something big, something bad. Or it could happen. One of the two. The bunker, reportedly built almost 20 years ago, can sustain hits from a range of existing weaponry, has command and control capabilities, and is connected to the Defense Ministry headquarters in Tel Aviv, the report said. Damn, that's crazy. Number two, Japan stock market. The Nikkei 225 is set to post its largest two-day drop in history, larger than Black Monday crash of 1987. This did happen, by the way. There's a video on this. I'm going to watch it here in a second, but Graham Stephan, he's a very well-spoken, very smart individual when it comes to money. So we'll see what he has to say about that as well. Number three, Bitcoin is down 20% the last week, 10% just today. Ooh, on August 4th too. Ethereum's down 31% of the week, 21% for the day. Ooh, it's not good, guys. If things start to drop. Number four, some trends showing the increased purchase of military stocks underway. Oh boy. This isn't fully verified, but you can see some patterns. Number five, talks about Federal Reserve considering lowering rates half a point next month to stabilize a massive potential stock market loss in August. That's crazy, dude. And fuck the Federal Reserve. Number six, Warren Buffett's Berkshire Hathaway dumps $75.5 billion worth of stock and halves Apple stake. That's crazy. And I'm pretty sure that actually happened or it's going to happen. I'll have to do more research on this topic here. They're now sitting on a record pile, cash pile of $276.9 billion. What does all of this mean? Nothing. Shit's about to hit the fan. A possible World War III is imminent, and America may be forced to get involved with Iran and Israel if this country attacks, right? Before, what to begin with? If Iran attacks, yep. The overdue recession is finally here. It really is. I've been telling people for a long time that there's going to be another recession. It's going to be very bad. Global recession after all the printing of money is here. Either way, I follow a basic rule. I lean 51% on future looking bright and 49% on only the paranoid survive. God is good, indeed. Amen. Now, I want to see what he has to say about this. And I want to learn more about it myself, so let's see what happens here, right?
Is America heading towards a recession?
The Dow's down more than 1,000 points as that global sell-off intensifies. Overnight, Japan's Nikkei plunged 12%. That is its worst day since 1987.
Seems like a recession cannot be ruled out just yet.
What's up, guys? It's Graham here. And apparently, we are look, as soon as I go out of town to film for my podcast, the entire market goes into a complete freefall of tails.
That's crazy timing right there. And nobody was expecting this, by the way.
Normally, I would just wait until I get home to make a video like this, but this is urgent, and we
country's falling apart.
I need to bring you up to speed with exactly what's happening, because this is not normal. For the first time since 2020, we have the perfect storm of events all taking place at the exact same time, causing some of the largest single-day losses since COVID, and we all know how that turned out. So even though I'm rushing this out without many edits to try to get you the information as soon as possible.
Oh, COVID, that was such a yikes time.
Possible. Let's talk about exactly what's happening, why the stock market has fallen so...
It's a good time for some, but a bad time for a lot of people, I think.
How much, what this means for you, and then what history tells us is most likely to happen next, since a lot of this is unprecedented. Although before we start, as usual, if you appreciate the makeshift studio like this and me filming really late at night to try to get you this information, all I ask in return is that you hit the like button or subscribe. That would mean the world to me. That's it. Thank you so much, and all of this begins here. The Japanese yen unwinding. Look, even though this sounds like a complicated term, it's really easy to understand if we break it down. On the surface, global economies are extremely interconnected. Like, what happens in the UK has the potential to impact the United States. China's decisions have a large effect on the demand of US dollars. And when one country is economically stronger than another, money tends to flow out and into something else, which is what's happening here. Even though our money has lost a significant amount of its purchasing power over the last 50 years, it's still the reserve currency in the world.
Makes sense.
And that means there's consistent demand for something like this. And no, I don't mean a $2 bill. I just keep this on me because it's good luck. Instead, I mean demand for U.S. Treasury.
That's true. I should have kept mine. Because I feel like the moment I got rid of them in whatever way I did, I don't remember how I spent it or whatever, but dude, I should have at least kept one. Because I feel like it actually, there was like a point period in my life where it started to go downhill, and it was like after I spent my last $2 bill, dude. Maybe it had to do with it. I don't know, man. What do you guys think?
Think of it like this.
Do you guys personally collect these things yourself? Do you carry at least $2 bill or anything like that? Do you care about that? If you personally, I never did, but I don't know, man. I'll have to keep an open mind, I guess.
Every country has their own unique currency, interest rate, and inflation rate, which is constantly measured by what it gets you in US dollars. This means there can be arbitrage opportunities where you borrow in one currency at a low interest rate, put that in another currency at a higher interest rate, and then you profit the difference, which is what's happening with Japan. For more than 30 years, the Japanese yen has been on a downtrend. In fact, their financial system is so bad, with decades of deflation and aging population and weak demand, that interest rates remain near historic lows just to incentivize spending, borrowing, and trade. And they could get away with that because until recently, inflation for them has been non-existent. Now, in most cases, this isn't that big of a deal, and global interest rates tend to balance each other out. But recently, something changed. Because the United States battled with record high inflation from 2022 to 23, they were forced to raise interest rates at the fastest pace ever in history. And all of a sudden, the United States was paying a very competitive interest rate that was completely risk-free. This presented a very unique opportunity where traders could borrow the yen at a low interest rate, put that in US dollars and treasuries at a high interest rate, and then profit the difference. On top of that, historically, the yen has also gone down in value relative to US dollars, which means that by the time you actually have to pay off your loan, it'll require fewer US dollars to be able to pay it back. So you could also make a profit on top of that by paying back less than you borrowed. As an example of this, in really simple terms, imagine you borrowed 1.3 million yen at 0.5% interest, which would get you 10,000 US dollars. You could then take that $10,000 and buy a 12-month treasury that earns 5.5%. If everything stays the exact same after 12 months, you now have $10,550, which is equivalent to 1,371,000 yen. You pay back the 1.3 million plus interest, and now you have roughly 500 US dollars worth of profit, all while investing in something that's backed by the full faith of the US government. However, like I mentioned earlier, there is one factor that could either be
we all know how well that goes, right?
Biggest blessing or curse when it comes to this, and that would be currency exchange. In our previous example, investors got very accustomed to being able to borrow 1.3 million worth of yen, get 10,000 US dollars, and 12 months later when they cash out, the yen weakened, and all of a sudden, the $10,000 now gets you 1.5 million yen. This means not only would you be able to make $500 worth of profit, but you also make an extra 200,000 yen for free, because the US dollar went up in value relative to what you borrowed. This, of course, seemed like a sure thing, until it wasn't. That's right, Japan recently raised their interest rates in response to their currency consistently losing value, and as a result, this caused the yen to strengthen and the dollar to decline. Or put another way, imagine you borrow 1.6 million yen to buy 10,000 US dollars. All of a sudden, the yen increases while the dollar declines.
Okay.
And now when you have to pay back the loan, your $10,000 only gets you 1.4 million yen. So you're $200,000 short, and you have to come up with the money, fast. What do? Unfortunately, this is exactly what's just happened. As you can see on July 10th, one US dollar bought you 161 yen. And now because of the rate hike, it only gives you 143 yen, a more than 10% decline from peak. And when you spread that across trillions of dollars invested throughout the United States in potentially leveraged positions, you have quite the shitstorm. Essentially, all of this means that trillions of dollars have been moved around or sold to pay off loans borrowed in another currency that now requires a lot more money to pay back than what was borrowed. And boom, we have the making for a stock market sell-off. In terms of how severe this is, Japan...
This is insane so far. This is a lot to unpack. I've just been quiet and listening and taking it all in, to be honest. I don't really have like a whole lot, like much to say right now, other than like placing your money in the stock market and then like things that are government regulated. It's not a good thing, dude. Like people who are smart with their money, they put their money into places where they can't, the money can basically not be touched by the government or any, you know, outside influences, which could negatively impact it. And instead, the money is guaranteed either to be safe or to be guaranteed to rise over time, no matter what. As long as it rises, as long as everything else rises, it rises. But there are ways to put your money into an investment for years over time to accumulate more and more money. It's called an annuity or an IUL.
Single biggest day loss since Black Monday of 1987. Basically, just imagine.
I actually happen to know a thing or two about those things. And to be honest, if you're interested, you can hit my DM. We can talk about it.
Imagine if our stock market was down 13% in a day versus the 3%. Well, that's what Japan just dealt with. Of course, some people might wonder,
why would Japan raise interest rates like this if it's going to be such a big issue?
The answer to that is inflation. Remember, when the Japanese yen declines in value, it requires more of that currency to be able to buy goods and services from other countries. So they were forced to raise interest rates to prevent their currency from falling even further. All of this accumulated into a rather large, abrupt sell-off that then causes a lot more fear, which causes an even bigger sell-off, which causes a lot more fear, and the cycle repeats itself. Although the reality is, this is just the tip of the iceberg, because on top of everything we have going on, we also have recession fears. Last week it was announced that US companies are no longer hiring at the same...
And the reason, sorry, I'm going to go back a little bit. The reason why it's better to put your money into life insurance is because, legally speaking, the government can't touch it. Even though it is a state regulated, federally and state regulated establishment, life insurance as a whole, it's actually guaranteed that your money will not fall if you put your money into life insurance. In fact, and that's if you're doing the new one, right? And I know what the new one is. I know all about it. The new one is what gives you the living benefits and, you know, the guaranteed outcome of what you need, you know? Whether it's financial security, whether it's life security, you know, protecting yourself, protecting other people. Or in this case, like investing your money somewhere into somewhere safe. The financial firm I work with offers all of these things and more. And so, you know, that's why I like to say it's important to actually invest in yourself.
There's a lot more fear and the cycle repeats itself. Although the reality is, this is just the tip of the iceberg, because on top of everything we have going on, we also have recession fears. Last week it was announced that US companies are no longer hiring at the same rate that was initially expected, with the chief economist of ZipRecruiter saying that the labor market's clearly no longer normalizing. Further deterioration could set off a negative cycle of job losses, consumer spending declines, business revenue declines, and more job cuts. As a result of that, the unemployment rate increased to 4.3%, which some say is an indicator that the recession that we've...
That's crazy.
Feared
for
the last
that's
2 years...
That's actually kind of high.
...is finally coming. Why? Well, in this case, we have what's called the SOM indicator, which measures the unemployment...
It's not as high as it could be, though, if I'm being honest.
...employment rate relative to where it was a year ago. And since the 1950s, it's correctly predicted just about every recession that we've seen. In this case, if the unemployment rate's three-month moving average rises half a percentage point from its previous year, a recession is either imminent or already underway. You can see where I'm going with this. Of course, do keep in mind that just like any indicator, there is a chance this could be a false positive. Like, take a look at the inverted yield curve, which has been inverted for more than 2 years without a recession. So I'll really leave it to you to come to your own conclusions, but one thing is for sure, rising unemployment will or can be an issue. For example, oil recently fell to $73 a barrel on fears that people are going to be cutting back, demand is going to weaken, and unemployment is going to increase. Because of that, it's expected that exporters may begin to scale back production, and the impacts of that could last a very long time. which is precisely maybe why Warren Buffett is selling. No joke, I think he's out here playing chess while everyone else is playing checkers, because his timing is impeccable. A few days ago, it was announced that Warren Buffett sold nearly half of his stake in Apple last quarter.
Yeah, this did happen, okay.
Quarter, raising $84 billion in the process. Not only did he seem to have timed the market perfectly compared to where we are today, but he also trimmed his position in Apple shortly before it was announced that Google violated antitrust laws by paying to have their search the default on Apple products, which made up 36% of the revenue. All of this means that Warren Buffett raised a substantial amount of cash before anything like this occurred, essentially at the peak of the market, which, great move. Although in terms of what this means for the future, here's where things get...
He knew it was gonna happen. That's why he did it. Like every, like all these, like, high level people with all these, all this money, like they know.
Very interesting.
People who are like well in touch with the stock market and everything like that, dude, they're, like they're insane.
Rate cuts.
On the level.
As of now, some economists are calling for the Federal Reserve to make an emergency, this is where things get very interesting, with rate cuts. As of now, some economists are calling for the Federal Reserve to make an emergency rate cut to help soften the blow. Others say the Federal Reserve is too late for rate cuts since they should have started sooner. And as of today, the market is pricing in the strong likelihood of a 50 basis point rate cut as soon as this September. Now if you think, oh great, the Federal Reserve is going to lower interest rates and then the stock market is going to go up. Keep in mind that since 1990, every single time the Federal Reserve has lowered rates, the stock market has declined. Why, you might wonder? Well, historically, the Federal Reserve has not lowered interest rates, unless they absolutely have to. It's not like they look at the stock market and say, ooh, the stock market's not going up as much as we want to. Let's just give a little rate cut and, there we go. Instead, they lower interest rates in anticipation of events that could be disastrous for the economy. And this has been the case the last three times, with the dot-com bubble, the Great Recession, and then shortly before COVID. In these cases, the stock market drop was not due to the rate cuts themselves, but rather the events that led to the rate cuts in the first place. So with all of this in mind, are we doomed? Not quite. As you can see, after enough time, there are plenty of occurrences where the market eventually begins to recover, some of which produce rather substantial returns. But you have to be patient. As of now, in the big picture, we're simply back to the same place the S&P 500 was 3 months ago, back in May. That's it. We're down less than 10% from the peak, which is extremely common. For example, on average, a 10% market correction happens about every 16 months, and throughout the last 20 years, a 10% drop has happened 11 times. So even though these circumstances are unique, stock market drops are not. Does this mean the stock market can't fall even further? No, but it is too early to tell if this is just a short-term hiccup or if this is a signal that something much deeper is happening and it could get a lot worse. I mean, there's certainly a chance the Federal Reserve lowers interest rates, and that worsens the problem with the yen, causing an even bigger sell-off than we saw now. Or there's the chance that this is an absolute nothing burger. People panicked for really no reason, it was a short-term hiccup, and everything gets back to normal within a few days. That's why I think, either way, no matter what happens, it's always important to be prepared for the worst. So here's what I recommend. I've said this many times before, but
absolutely, dude. This is what I was saying earlier. You gotta prepare for the future. You have to have your money somewhere safe, where it's guaranteed to rise over time, where it's, you know, you're guaranteed not to lose, right? You gotta prepare yourself, and then... And you have to prepare yourself in other ways, not just like with your money, but your life altogether, you know what I mean?
Number one, always keep a 3 to 6 month emergency fund available at all times. This way, you're not going to have to sell off your stocks in the event of a reduction in income, you lose your job, or something happens where you have to sell at a loss. An emergency fund should be able to hold you through. Second, it's really important to diversify your assets.
Emergency fund's huge.
Just like tech stocks lost about 78% during the dot-com bubble, if you're all in really volatile stocks or cryptocurrencies, there's a chance that you could lose a lot of money. At the end of the day, the more you diversify, the less volatility you're going to have, and the more insulated you're going to be in the event something happens. And that's what I do. I try to be equally as diversified throughout cash, treasuries, index funds, real estate, and cryptocurrencies. So if something happens to one, I have something else to fall back on, and if they all go down, I still have some cash in the...
I have none of this.
...sidelines to be able to continue buying it. Third, speaking of buying in, continue buying it. Look, I know how gut-wrenching it can be to watch your investments drop 10 to 20% value. You think you're getting a great deal by...
Is the average person actually even doing all this? Like, are they actually buying these, like, cryptocurrencies, these stocks, you know, these things that he's talking about? Do you guys do this? I've never been able to actually get into this myself. I've never had, I guess, the extra money to, on the side to do it. You know, I guess all my money has been put towards other more important things, such as bills, necessities, things like that. You know what I mean?
Buying back in, and then they drop another 10 or 20%.
It's like these people just have an extra $1,000 laying around they can do that with. That's cool, but I don't know how you, like, the average person is supposed to get that. You know what I mean?
And it continues doing this until you're out of money, and then you panic.
And obviously, I'm not just, you know, like, at the time when I was thinking about trying it, you know, I was only working, like, a regular 9 to 5, right? Like, that's not a very good place to be, for one, because it's only, like, One, it's not guaranteed income because you can get fired anytime and replaced. Two, it's hourly pay, so you're spending your time for your money, right? Like way more time than what you have to. And three, it's the payout's not good enough, man. You're never gonna get paid enough, simply because 9-to-5 jobs, they tax you for like at least 40% of your fucking money for the government.
Excel, and then everything goes up in price. I know it can be extremely discouraging. That is why study after study shows the best strategy out there is to continue buying and holding on a regular basis consistently. That's it. But even though a typical bear market might lose you 33%, a bull market on average sees a gain of 265% and lasts almost 5 times longer. So sure, losing money isn't exactly exciting, but with every loss comes the equal opportunity for a much bigger potential gain. That brings us to number four, don't panic sell. I've noticed that the psychology that causes you to want to sell off your investments when everything goes down is the same psychology that causes you to want to buy back in at the peak because of FOMO. Resist it, do not do it, just stay the course as usual. On top of that, another aspect to consider is that over the...
Don't panic in general, dude. Like, you have to, like, you can't make all of your decisions based upon your emotions. In fact, 90% or all of your decisions should not be emotionally based. They should be logically based, right? I mean, there's like that's a small percentage in there, like, for some situations that maybe I'm not thinking about right now, but maybe you guys are thinking about certain circumstances you've been in where emotions have been helpful in decision making, and maybe that's the case, but even you can probably agree that emotions tend to do more harm than good when it comes to decision making, without a doubt. You just have to, like, trusting your gut is pretty huge. Like, trust your spirit, trust, you know, like, what's calling from within of what you should do. And if you don't really have that feeling all too well, just use your common sense, use your logic, you know what I mean?
For the last 20 years, a $10,000 investment in the S&P 500 would have grown to $64,000 if you just kept the money invested without touching it. However, if you miss the best 30 days over 20 years, your profits completely evaporate, as in, you make no money, which, by the way, typically happen after the worst days. Assuming you could do that step, though, number five, always keep a steady income. The biggest risk I see with a stock market drop like this is that, depending on the underlying conditions, it could be associated with a job loss or a reduction in income that could affect your ability to either continue buying in or not to sell if you need the money. Ultimately, you want to make sure you have a consistent income so that you can keep buying in or you don't need to sell your investments should something happen. And finally, six, if you're extra paranoid, keep some more cash on the sidelines. I know statistically this is not the best choice if you want to maximize returns, but for peace of mind, this is what it usually takes. I typically have a little extra cash on the sidelines because it helps me sleep at night. I know it's not optimal, but for peace of mind, I think it's worth it. Oh, and then an honorary number seven. If you need the money in the short term, over the next 3 to 5 years, it's probably not a good idea to invest in the stock market. That is because over the short term, it's not guaranteed that you're going to make money. And even over the next 10 years, there's nothing that says you can't lose money over that time frame. That's why I see this as a very long-term investment strategy. And if you aren't prepared to hold these investments for at least 10 to 20 years, I might recommend against it. Or at least just know what you're getting into. Ultimately, time is going to tell how this plays out. Typically, we see some of the best days after the worst, so I would not be surprised if over the next few days the market goes up quite a bit, and then maybe it goes down before it goes up quite a bit. It's a roller coaster. It's a coin toss, heads or tails, in terms of what happens, but let me know.
So what I was saying earlier about investing long-term with the annuity or IOL, you know what I mean? It's a stock that's basically guaranteed to rise. It's guaranteed not to fail. You know what I mean? It's the exact opposite of going to college. Whereas that's basically investing in stocks is guaranteed to fail. But if you guys like what I've said so far, if you guys like this video so far, if you guys like what you see so far, be sure to drop a like, be sure to share it with your homies.
Down below in the comment section, I'll do my best.
I hope you guys found something useful from this. If you want to show love, be sure to subscribe to Patreon. That's where I actually have some exclusive uncut content from other videos posted on there. I know my plus and a glass of boss. Wanna chill, ask your boss. Hope that job is paying off. Cash, cash, cash. All I fucking see is cash. Get cash, cash, cash.